another study by Van Dillen. So they start stiffening up elsewhere. They have too much motion somewhere, they start breaking down elsewhere. Start stiffening up. And they have lack of motor function, meaning they don't have the strength. So talking about the hip, I'm going to talk very briefly. This is a very important topic for me. Hip morphology, cam lesions, pincer lesions, acetabular versions. This is, for the purpose of this class, I just want to talk about architecture. The patient comes to you, has architectural deficits. Can we change them with motor control and manual therapy? A little bit, but what we're trying to do is change their movement patterns and then beat themselves up further. That's a little picture from 2004. The one on the top in the A, the normal hip, you have a little bit of overgrowth there for a cam lesion. And then you have a pincer lesion on the top, and you have a combination. And this is what is happening to all these patients who need the labor repairs and the FAA osteochondroplasties. But there's we know how now. We know what is going on, but we don't really know why. So surgeons are getting better and better treating this. We're probably doing a better job rehabbing it. But realistically, why are people breaking down at the hip? Probably, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say probably because they have crappy motor control. They have an inability for the muscles to pull themselves in the right spot. And they start breaking down elsewhere. They're not supposed to rotate at the spine so that they have too much rotation at the spine. The hip goes forward, hinges on the tissue. You start to have bony overgrowth and bony changes, architectural changes. And you have dysfunction that leads to a very serious condition that's hard to treat. A little bit on hip musculature. Hips are very, very important. Not that I wanted to show you a picture of someone's bum, but gluteus maximus, minimus, medius, and deep lateral rotators are the unsung heroes of the war on back pain and hip pain. Patients generally come to my office, I check their functionality, and I realize that their butt is just for show. They're just wearing it. They're not actually using it. So what happens in a hip case, back to the hip case, is as they are stepping forward, instead of their glutes and the medial aspect of the hamstring and the adductor group working properly to pull their hip in the socket, that hip is going forward, pinching on their labrum, breaking things down. So if we're looking at getting the functionality back, we have to appreciate the symphony again. The musicians who are really holding it all together, holding that note together so that it can work efficiently. Individual low back pain, move different. I already said this, so I don't want to say it again. Just like to add more and more slides on research to make it look smart. Patients move different than patients who do not have back pain. We know that, we see this all the time. They're kinesiophobic perhaps, they arch when they shouldn't be arching, they don't curve reverse. They ask the question is why? From a motor control standpoint, is the right muscles aren't working, the wrong muscles are working too much. Decreased performance of lateral rotation, seen low back pain, again, we saw it before. And you guys, if you're big research readers, you'll find one author will put the same thing out in four different ways to get four different papers published. But the cool thing is it really just hits home in the importance. And the importance here is that hip musculature, back musculature, firing the right way really protects the spine. And the cool thing is, it's trainable. We can get this back. Syndromes, I'm going to blast through these. We'll talk about it a little bit more in the lab portion of it. So in the MSI approach, they're big into naming, diagnosing. We have to diagnose things. So what we look at is, does it hurt when it flexes? Called a flexion syndrome. Does it hurt when it extends? It's an extension syndrome. Does it hurt when it rotates? Rotation syndrome. Does it hurt when it rotates and extends? Flexion rotation. So oftentimes, you'll see any combination of these. Patients will have problems with rotation and flexion and extension. Very, very straightforward examination. We go through, you guys can read these online. We have these published on the IPTA website. But looking at extension syndrome. So patients who have extension syndrome have very, very weak abdominals. They have increased length. This is that spring that's too mobile. And they just kind of pull it out there. Or they're trained to be this way. Gymnasts don't have really weak abdominals, they're great, but they train to be this way. What happens, I say it's great, they work, but they have too much length. They're always back here. They're too short here, and they're too long here. So abdominals have poor control, and too long. Flexion syndrome, back extensors are poor and long in length. I've appreciated the fact that I probably have a little bit of this myself, because I like to do this. So my theory is my mid-back muscle is too damn long. My other muscles here are probably too short. So I've got to build sarcomere strength and functionality of these guys to get this up. Because this is not my go-to posture. I could do it all day long if I know it. Or if April's in my clinic, say, Bob, you're sitting like a question mark again. So I gotta bring myself upright. But really, from a motor control point of view, I might need to just stiffen up my upper back muscles. Not stiffen up my back, but stiffen up my upper back muscles. I don't know what else is good on this one. Stiff extensors. So they'll have stiff muscle that extend the hip as well. Rotation syndromes are generally very poor control of the muscles that help rotate the spine. The obliques, the external obliques, really not working well, and perhaps the hip rotators too, not working so well. Movement exam, I'm going to blow through this because we're going to come back to this. This will make a lot more sense if I have a patient in front of you. When we look at patients, it's how they look. What do they look like? Are they flat? Are they extended? Are they rotated? Is one hip rotated to the other? We're looking for kind of big things. But if we look for very minute things, we probably aren't going to get it. If we look for big things, we'll probably make a big change if we change it. The 1 foot pronated or supinated. They'll be at crest level, tilting the pelvis. Then when you look at how they move, that's the whole thing about a movement exam. When they move, do they bend forward? Do they reverse curve properly? Is their spine moving into all sorts of flexion and their hips aren't? Or are their hips flexing and their back is? What's it like with side bending? Symmetry one side to the other. Are they bending where they're supposed to or they're not? Are they all in the lumbar spine hinging like a hinge on a door? Or do they share that motion with the other vertebral segment? Single leg stance. How does the hip work? Do they drop? Do they flatten? Yeah, we'll be back to this very soon during the demonstration. We'll go through this a little bit more succinctly here. Spinal alignment and sitting. What's the strength of the hips look like? What are the strength of their hip flexors, their hip rotators? What's the length of their hamstring? Do they have appropriate length, or are they a little too stiff? Supine. Again, how those muscles work. What happens when you flex the leg up actively? What happens when you have passively? Do they have relative stiffness in the long spot? Do they have active control of their pelvis, or do they flop around? Are they wobbling around? Sidelines. What's their glute med doing? Are they firing up? Are they getting strong contractions? Do they have stability there? Or are they wiggling around in their spine? So I hated the clam exercise. During my fellowship, I would holler at anyone who did clams. I don't know why I hated them, but I just hated them. You go to any PT clinic, they're all doing clams. So I was talking to Shirley Charman when she's at UIC. I said, I hate this exercise. I can't handle it. She goes, let me see how you do it. So I had someone do a clam. She goes, that's a bad clam. Bad clam. You guys ever eaten clams and you eat a bad clam and spit it right out? Well, I'm going to ask you guys to spit out bad clams and look over for the good tasty clams. That's weird at this time of the morning. But what is a good clam? A good clam is having hip abduction and lateral rotation at the hip socket with a good stable pelvis. So if their obliques are firing up, and if they could sit lay on a side lay on a table and have stability where the spine is neutral, not necessarily with any pillow or support unless it's in an acute state, and they can rotate only at that segment, not rotate at the spine, that's a good clam, and that's important for motor control and function. But we send our patients home doing these awful clams. Oh, my back is hurting after I do exercise. Why? I didn't teach them to do it right. I actually just stopped doing it, but now I'm back. I like good clams. Prone flexion. Is they bend up? Is it the rectus femoris? Is it too tight? Is it too stiff? Is it long enough? Or do they have poor abdominal function? Are they just wiggling around? Are they twisting? Where is that degeneration going on? What is the Craig test? Craig's test is important because we want to look at the architecture of the hip. What's going on at that hip? Does it antivert? Does it retrovert? Is there something we can fix, or is it something we have to some activity modifications so they don't be too focused. What's the glute max doing? Is it working? What's the strength? Is the hamstring, glute, and core muscles firing at an appropriate synergy? Quadruped. How do they move in these different patterns? Are they doing it right? Are they twisting at it towards you. What's the role of biomechanics? Chris Powers, California, is big on patellofemoral. What if you put on full of femoral sliding in my presentation? Well, if you think about what's going on in the knee, we have to appreciate what's going on in the hip. Because what's happening is the obliques aren't working properly in the abdominal wall. Your hip rotators are going inward. Your adducting is really sloppy. It hurts the knee. So if we spend all day long taping the knee, doing lots of straight leg raises, doing quad sets, doing all sorts of running and jumping drills, and we don't like the biomechanics. Now this is some fancy stuff. If you have an iPhone with a, what do they call it, not mover sense, huddle tightening, new thing on an iPhone, just have them run and jump. Have them start and stop. See what's going on in their hips. And then you tell them to stop it. Do it the right way. And all of a sudden they start building up strength and relative stiffness of the right muscles. And then they're good. And they're happy. They stop being your patient for that episode. And then they bring in their other patients. Like, this guy's brilliant. Use the phone to see how well I do. What are the treatment principles? A failed test becomes the treatment. So big in MSI world is not doing 122 exercises, but doing 2 or 3 exercises 122 times. Get what you train. Be very specific of what you train. Don't let them do bad clamps. Don't let them do sloppy technique. Train to improve the function of muscles with precise motion. Same thing I just said. Remember that tighten slide. Improve that tighten. Build up those sarcomeres. Get some stiffness in the right muscles. Get some length in the other muscles. So how do we lengthen the other muscles? Stiffen up the ones that are too loose. And actively move in an appropriate pattern so the body starts moving efficiently. And very important, improve the muscles to act as the go-to muscles. So if your rectus abdominis is the go-to muscle, you're always going to flex. If your obliques are the go-to muscles, then you'll have a nice little stability through the pelvis. Kind of in conclusion, I've been talking a long time. Thank you guys for not falling asleep yet. Muscle dysfunction factors. Hip extensors gives you a lumbar. So if you have weak hip extensors or inefficient hip extensors, you can have a lumbar flexion syndrome. That means the tush muscle is, you're just wearing that for show. They're not working to protect the back. You have flexion syndrome. Weak hip flexors or inefficient hip flexors, you're going to have more of a lumbar extension syndrome. Now that's the patient who's really arched back. They're moving very inefficiently. Your dancer, your ballet person, your person has stenosis. They're just using the muscles the wrong way. They're always compressing posteriorly. Hip rotator, weak hip rotators and abductors, you're going to have that rotation syndrome. So you say, Bob, what if you have both? Or all three? All three is really rough. You generally have one or two, and those two would be a rotation and a flexion extension. Structurally, antiversion and retroversion, what happens? Your spine is going to have to move around that architecture. So if you do an examination and you find you have some architectural issues, instead of getting all excited and sending you to a surgeon to get it cut off, say, well, let's move your hip out a little bit. Let's see if we can modify your activity a little bit, change the way you do your motion control. Cam pincer, we just talked about that. But if you have cam pincer, you're generally going to have a lumbar dysfunction. And it's generally going to be a flexion dysfunction. Those patients come in after hip surgeries, about week 6, let's start treating your back. How do you know my back hurts? Like, guys, you've been breaking down for a year and a half, your back's going to hurt for 2 years. And then hip and lumbar degenerative joint disease, you can see in both rotation and lumbar extension syndrome. And then off to Eva, right?
Yes. Right. I need to move my skeleton over, so if you want to take a quick stretch break, hopefully your bladder's actually full, yeah, but 2 second stretch break and move on. And